Last week, the sermon title last week was No Ordinary Person, No Ordinary Man. We're in the story and we're moving through the Bible in a chronological way and we're in the life of Jesus. And last week, the title was No Ordinary Man. This week, we're dialing it up a bit. Now it's Jesus, the Son of God. Last week, we learned about the way Jesus treated other people and what he told his disciples early on in his ministry with them when he quoted to them the prophet Hosea and said, "Learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice." Well, we're going to continue to walk down that theme a little bit today. But first, let's see if our video will work. Thank you, Robert.
Because of what Jesus said and did, people wondered who Jesus was. His followers said to him, "Some people say you are John the Baptist, come back to life. Some say you are Elijah or one of the other prophets." "What about you?" Jesus asked. "Who do you say that I am?" Jesus' follower Peter spoke up. "You are the Messiah." But Jesus told them not to tell anyone yet. 6 days later, Jesus took Peter and two of the other disciples, James and John, high up on a mountain. When they got to the top, Jesus' appearance suddenly changed. His face shined like the sun, and his clothes became as white as light. Two men appeared next to him. They were Moses and Elijah. Then a voice came from the clouds, "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." The disciples fell down terrified. When they got up and opened their eyes, only Jesus remained. From there, Jesus and his followers traveled to Jerusalem for a huge festival. Jesus went to the temple to share some of his thoughts with the crowd. There, the religious leaders became very angry at what Jesus was teaching. They knew he was claiming that he was the Messiah, the king they'd been waiting for. Enraged, they picked up stones to kill Jesus, but he managed to escape. After leaving Jerusalem, Jesus continued to teach and perform miracles. He heard that one of his good friends, Lazarus, was sick. So Jesus and the disciples traveled to where he lived. When they arrived, they discovered that Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. Jesus went to the tomb where Lazarus was buried, had the stone rolled away, and raised him from the dead. Soon it was time to go back again to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. Two of his followers brought Jesus a mule to ride on as he came into the city. When he did, huge crowds gathered along the streets, shouting, "Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord!" The crowds loved Jesus. But it didn't take long before he began clashing with the religious leaders again. He exposed their corruption and threatened their authority. So the leaders began devising a plan to get Jesus arrested. They met with Judas, one of Jesus' followers, who agreed to turn Jesus in to the authorities in exchange for some money. Then the religious leaders waited for the right opportunity to arrest him.
So as I studied and prepared for my sermon last week, I got this visual impression that I thought was pretty profound in the sense that I recognize that when you bring a sacrifice to God, your direction is toward God. And when he says, "I desire mercy, not sacrifice," it can't mean that God wants mercy from us. Because God doesn't need mercy from us. So it must mean that what God desires is for us to turn away from him toward others and show mercy to them. And as we listen to the stories about Jesus, No Ordinary Man, one of the things we discovered was that Jesus reached out to people who were undesirables, They were marginalized. They were sick, or they were Samaritans. Jesus reached out to these people that were the undesirables of his day, and it made clear to us that as followers of Jesus, we need to follow his example. That is, that when we want to be closer to God, we recognize and learn that what God desires of us is to show people, all kinds of people, mercy. But this week takes it up a notch. This week requires an even more radical understanding, because Jesus also taught his disciples this: blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. It's not just undesirable people we're supposed to show God's love to. It's people who are ready to hurt you. It's people who are going to say nasty things about you, who are going to betray you, who are going to make things up to hurt your reputation. And what you're called to do, regardless of what they do, is reflect God's love to them. Now, that's a radical ask, and it's not an easy thing to do. But what Jesus is doing is he's telling us that we need to be like him, because what he says to his disciples is, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. Jesus isn't just asking us to do that. This is what he did. And when he taught this to his disciples, do you know how they reacted? No way. His top dog disciple, Peter, says, no, 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 no. We're not going to let that happen. And Jesus says to his best friend, Peter, get behind me, Satan. It's not a very nice thing to say to your best friend. But you see, it's because it's just too radical. It just seems like it's too much to expect that, well, to quote Scripture, while we are yet sinners, Christ dies for us. That Jesus was willing to die for us, and Jesus was willing to die for the very people who were brutalizing him and crucifying him. To quote Jesus again, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Do not suppose, Matthew 10 teaches us, that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For how many people that's their favorite Bible verse? We like to move by that one. We prefer the words of the angels or Jesus when they show up and then it says, be not afraid, peace be with you. Those are the texts we want. But instead, Jesus is saying, hey, look, if you reflect the truth of who I am, people will be mad at you. People will oppose you. When you challenge their authority by recognizing my authority, people will get upset with you. Hopefully this never happened to the manager at the La Encantada Apple Store, but sometimes when you say to an irate person, hi, what's your name? When they've been screaming at you, instead of them saying, Jim, they say, right? I mean, sometimes when you're nice to people who are angry at you, they get angrier. It doesn't always work to calm them down with niceness, does it? And that's probably what the scripture's talking about when it says it's like pouring coals over their head. But you see, when Jesus says to them, essentially, I am God, which is what his words were communicating, most of them didn't believe him. Occasionally at the church council, we'll talk about ways to grow the church. What are some things we can do to bring more people? And I'm just kind of thinking to myself, I'm wondering how many people would come next week if what I said today was, I am God. I got a feeling it would be less instead of more. But of course, the reason it would be less instead of more is because I'm not God. And that would be delusional if I said it and meant it. But Jesus claims to be, and in fact is, the Son of God. And because of that, if we believe that, then our response is not the response of the religious leaders of his day, which was to pick up stones. Our response is to bow with our faces to the ground. I surrender all. If we believe that Jesus is who he claimed to be, then our response is full allegiance. I think it was 1994, we were watching the Olympics. I tend to be glued to the television during the Olympic Games, although more so in the past than the present, but we were watching the Olympics, and it was the final round of the women's gymnastics, a team competition. And Carrie Strug came out to be the last vaulter for the U.S., and if she nailed it, if she scored as well as they knew she could score, the women would win the gold medal. But after her first vault, she was clearly seriously injured. Now, Marilyn and I have radically different backgrounds. I, having been involved in a number of competitive sports, Marilyn, pretty much not at all. And Marilyn has a mother's heart, right? So when we're watching this together, she's going, oh, she's hurt. Boy, I hope they're going to take care of her. You know, and the coaches run out and they come out and they feel, and then she lines up to do the second vault and Marilyn is not happy. Well, she could really get hurt. It's only a game after all. Well, if you remember that, as most Americans do, she went on to land her vault, which most people couldn't do with two legs, with essentially one leg, and in so, helped the women to capture the Olympic gold medal for the U.S. women's gymnastics team. And sort of forever has become this hero of perseverance and dedication and commitment to her team and to our country. Well, it was only a game. You know, there's some elements in which Marilyn's probably right about this, but for me, I was just awed by that level of commitment. I am not a military person. I've never had the honor of serving in the military. My mom did, and so I did grow up in a household where patriotism was very, very highly valued. But I understand that there is a difference between when I stand before the flag and say the Pledge of Allegiance and when someone in the military does. See, I get that when they're saying the Pledge of Allegiance, that they're making a commitment that says, I'm gonna put our country before my own life. And I understand that there's a possibility that this allegiance may cost me my life. Because I know that I'm pledging myself to something greater than I am. If Jesus is who he says he is, then we, if we believe it, need to be all in. I get asked occasionally by some of my pastor friends what I teach about tithing. There's a subcurrent in the conversation because they think that when I fail to teach tithing to y'all, that I'm kind of milquetoast. Basically, I'm letting you get away with a lower commitment than what the scripture requires. See, the Bible teaches in the Old Testament that the appropriate response to God for the blessings that we receive is that we give back to God 10% of what God gives to us. That's called a tithe. And it was even clearer and far more confusing at the same time because, you see, they were an agrarian society. And so a lot of what they were giving as this 10% sacrifice was the first fruits of a harvest. Well, I don't know if any of you are farmers, but it's pretty hard to know how much you're going to harvest until you harvest it. But what they were asked to do was to give a 10% portion of the first fruits of what they thought they were going to harvest. So it wasn't sort of a known easy commodity math equation. It really was it looks like it's going to be this, so I'm giving you, God, what I think is going to be 10%. What happens if the rest of the harvest doesn't come in? Oh, well, it was a good guess. That's what tithing teaches in the Old Testament. But the New Testament doesn't teach tithing. The New Testament says Jesus is the Son of God, and therefore God gets everything. All that we have and all that we are should be dedicated to God such that we are stewards. We're going to do with all of what God has given us whatever it is that God requires of us, whatever it is he asks of us. Because Jesus is the Son of God. And like I said last week, we're going to respond to a world who may laugh at us, may say our faith is a crutch, may belittle us for the morals that we choose to live by, and we're going to continue to treat them the way we know God in his love treats them, even when they attack us, even when they smear our reputation, even if they lie about us, because it's not about who they are and it's not about what they do. It's instead about who Jesus is. the Son of God, who gave his life for you and I so that we could live our lives for him. All in, full allegiance, because he is worthy. Amen.